because of this, this corner right here.
If the tennis courts, clearly it's an understanding that they don't need to be built. If they were to be built today, it would be my understanding that they would have to be built under the existing ordinance. Wouldn't that be correct, Maureen?
I have to honestly say that I don't feel confident in interpreting the grandfathering sections of the zoning ordinance. I leave that to the code enforcement officer.
All right. Well, I won't say any more than that. It's not really an issue.
I'm going back to this road issue. I'm looking at the deed into the Tookers. Also conveying hereby a 1/4 interest in common with the grantor in and to the areas designated common areas shown on the plan, together with a 1 common interest in and to Woods Knoll Drive, which is a private road for the benefit of the owners of Lot 1 through 4. To me, even looking at it now, it seems to make it separate from the common area. It would be tidier if there was, I'm not sure what to do.
The interest doesn't change from the interest in the
road
to the other interest in the common area, and I can't see why they need any more interest than 1/4 interest per site owner.
They can drive whatever they want.
I would assume that that would be the same as that short distance between the the actual road and all of the other lots. It's just
there
a smaller area.
There is a short
area.
Distance, yeah. Okay, I'll back off on that. We have any further discussion?
The only other discussion is that neck of the road at that point now serves as a part of the T intersection, and that it would seem that whatever, I assume the driveway is coming off that little 40-foot turnaround.
Mm-hmm.
It's coming off the end of the road. Excuse me?
There's the public access waiver requirements specifically state that you can't have a driveway come off of a turnaround. The problem is that if Public Works are, this is a private road, but it's supposed to be open, and it, if you have it as a turner, if you have it as part of a driveway, people tend to treat it as part of their driveway and they put things in it.
Except that in this case, it doesn't fall within the boundary line of the private property owner. They have a 1/4 interest, I understand, but is there any way of noting the plan or further restricting that area so it's maintained for emergency vehicle turnaround?
Yep.
For example, in the fall when you tar the driveway, when you put the sealer on it, the can should be held back the distance of that turnaround.
You could easily do that with just a note on the plan that there can be no parking within the turnaround area as noted on the plan of Woods Knoll Drive. I think you had to change the street name. I haven't got it right once today. Any further comment? Discussion? In this case, we have a motion.
Ms. Larden.
I propose the following motion for the board to consider. Finding of facts. 1, Robert and Elizabeth Barton are requesting an amendment to the previously approved Woods Knoll subdivision, which requires review under section 16-2-5 of the subdivision ordinance. 2, completion of the site improvements depicted on the plans are necessary to assure that the subdivision is in compliance with town standards. 3, the applicants have indicated that they intend to pave the remainder of Woods Knoll Road. 4, the proposed subdivision amendment substantially complies with section 16-2-5 of the subdivision ordinance. Decision, therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Robert and Elizabeth Barton for an amendment to the Woods Knoll subdivision located off of Old Ocean House Road be approved subject to the following conditions. 1, that a revised plan shall be submitted to the town showing details for paving the remainder of the roadway. Such paving shall be done in accordance with the town's ordinances. 2, a note shall be added to the plan to indicate that the turnaround area be maintained free of obstructions. 3, granite monumentation shall be installed in accordance with the original plan. 4, site distance at the intersection of Woods Knoll Road and Old Ocean House Road shall be improved by trimming brushes required by the town's ordinance.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. I'm sorry.
I just had a discussion, but go ahead, Beau.
No, you can discuss.
No, it was just the issue of requiring depiction of the improvements of the their choice to surface the road. I'm not sure that that needs to be a part of, at least in my mind's eye, approval of this request. And I'm just quickly trying to think through my mind, is it even warranted, number one? Number two, could you read back through how you wrote that?
I'll read what I said, and I certainly would defer to Maureen if she thinks it's unnecessary. What I'm talking about in the paving is I just don't want code enforcement to go to them when they're paving and say, look, you need planning board approval because this is a change to an approved subdivision plan. That's my only intent, and I may be wrong. But what I had said was under one of the conditions that a revised plan shall be submitted to the town showing details for paving the remainder of the roadway. Such paving shall be done in accordance with the town's ordinances.
Because it just sounds like, because it says shall be done, that we're deeming it that it's a requirement of this approval that it be paved. And I understand that they intend to, but I'm not sure that we want to, or this board member wants to require that they do that. Maybe it's just a minor issue.
I did indicate in the findings of fact that they indicated that they intend to pave, and if they would not be stopped if they intend to pave with no action on this board, I would drop both that finding. Well, I'd leave the finding because they have indicated that. I would certainly agree to eliminating that condition.
I think we ought to leave the motion as is.
Pardon?
I think we ought to leave the motion as is.
I know what you're saying, Steve. I agree with you.
We're adding a condition that
the applicant is
you don't have any problem.
We don't have a problem with that.
Okay,
all right,
fine.
Let's just then. This,
thank you.
I know what you're saying. All those in favor of the motion as read, raise your right hand. All those opposed, it's unanimous.
Great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. The next item of business tonight is the Kinder Corner site plan, a request by John and Jane McFeeney for site plan review of Kinder Corner, a retail shop in the Pond Cove Shopping Center. We're looking at site plan completeness in accordance with section 19.2.10 of the zoning ordinance. And I am unfortunately going to have to excuse myself from this. I got a wonderful job working for biggest real estate law firm in town, and we represent the owners of the parking lot.
What's the parking lot?
I've had too much. This is the shopping center, and I'm going to ask Janet McKinney, please. Thank you.
Hi, Mr. McKinney. Would you like to identify yourself for the record and give us a short introduction to this project?
I'm John McKinney, and myself, along with my wife Jane, are trying to open up a store, a business, in the Pond Cove Shopping Center in the location that was prior operated as a beauty salon. And what we're trying to open is a children's resale store for children's new and used clothing. And that's basically it.
Okay. This is a question of site plan completeness. Maureen, could I ask you to summarize the completeness issues?
The applicant has stated this is an existing building, so there are some interesting issues for the board in terms of how much information you want to require. The applicants did make a submission last month in consultation with Planning Board Chair. It was not placed on the agenda because there was insufficient right title or interest demonstrated by the applicant. And that has been, I think, addressed this month, starting with one. Building elevations have not been provided. It is an existing building. And the applicant has stated they're not proposing any exterior changes. Building setbacks have not been depicted on the plan. Again, the building is existing. Under 12B, the applicant has requested a waiver of information on the sanitary waste disposal system. It is my understanding that there were some problems with that system earlier this year. I don't know the extent of it. I don't know if there have been any changes to the system since that time. The applicants are relying on plans that are existing plans. I don't think there's been any research into if anything's changed on that. Under 12D, a waiver of information and solid waste disposal, any use on this property, I would assume there would be some kind of solid waste that would be generated. Under 14, lighting details, typically the board receives information on lighting either existing or proposed on a site because you're right later required to determine whether lighting is sufficient. And under 15, just so the board notes, the applicant has stated that they do not propose to post a new sign, that they are merely going to change a panel in the existing sign. And my understanding is the code enforcement officer does not consider that a new sign and something that would come under the new sign ordinance. So those are the items that have been identified in this memo. Are there any questions?
Mr. McThaney, I'd like to hear from you about what the sanitary waste disposal system is that's on site now. Can you tell us about that?
Are you talking about waste that we would generate within the store?
Yes.
Basically, I really don't know if there's any on site. Our operation in the past, and this will be the fourth store that my wife has run, is that we basically take it home with us. It's just normally one small garbage bag at the outset a day. Occasionally, it's not even that much. And we take it home with us. We take it to the dump. We take our household refuse to the dump. So I don't know if there is a communal dumpster on site, but we hadn't planned on using it anyway.
Okay.
Excuse me. Did you ask about sanitary or solid waste?
I was going to ask about both of them. Go ahead. Talk to me about all kinds of waste.
In regard to restrooms, that type of waste, there are two restrooms on the site, one of which we're not going to use. We're going to use it as a storeroom. The other one will be available to there'll be one employee to begin with. Hopefully in the future there may be two, but that we're not sure of at this point. The waste that was generated prior to it being a beauty salon was obviously a much larger amount than what we're going to generate, which will be just basically a washroom. I guess they'll make coffee occasionally, and the use of the restroom by the employee. And I'm sure there'll be a mother and a kid or two a day.
Which you won't turn away, right?
No.
Any other questions?
I'm sure. Perhaps I can answer, and maybe I don't have the right instance. You mentioned a problem with the sanitary sewer. It's a public sewer system. There was a problem at that shopping center, and I just happened to know about it. I was involved in it at the time, that during the process of groundwater monitoring wells for soils contamination, the environmental engineering firm drilled one of the water monitoring wells directly through the sewer pipe and caused a slight problem in the sewer system. And
when did this occur? Last year? Within the last year or so?
The last year to 18 months. Yeah. Yeah, I hope so.
I'd just like to take this from another direction in terms of... good luck to that. You're really caught in an unusual situation here. The Town Center Committee is studying the shopping center and issues related to, and we've had discussions, I believe, in workshop sessions about what to expect from a site plan. Is that more of an imposition on someone coming who's really a tenant in a shopping center and simply wanting to move in where there's a similar use already has been present with no perceived impact? So I see many of the issues that you want to waive really, to me, rest with the infrastructure capabilities of the shopping center. I think it would be, as you as a tenant should know, whether or not you're going to have access to a dumpster or solid waste or how. Let me ask a question. I'm assuming you're a tenant. You're not a owner in the shopping center?
Just a tenant.
Okay. That there should be an understanding in the lease of what you have access to. An issue impact on the sewer problem, sanitary sewer, I'd simply say that's an owner's responsibility to be sure that they're providing sanitary sewer to you, and I don't see anything in your proposed use that's more, if you were proposing a slaughter operation or some surgical unit, I could see a major issue, but or a car wash. The other thing that the Town Center Commission Committee has brought up as an issue is exterior glass area and keeping storefronts open and visible from the public rather than making the windows small and filling them up with advertising. And if you're not proposing to make any changes, I don't see that we have anything to review here, although I certainly would be interested to see something if you were to propose changes.
Mm-hmm.
The only other question I would have, Maureen, is there any way of understanding the again, the impact on parking, the adequacy of parking? Is there adequate parking in that shopping center to meet the zoning ordinance for the proposed use?
I believe the applicant has submitted information on that. They talked about the number of employees and number of parking spaces they feel that they will need, and I believe you're stating that you think you're going to use less than was previously used.
Much less.
Okay. Well, I've gone way beyond completeness issues. I guess what I'd like to do is get this passed through tonight, deem it complete. Is it appropriate to take action on it tonight? Asking you. Yeah.
Well, your procedure is to deem something complete, then to determine whether or not you want to hold a public hearing, and then to discuss the merits of the application. Public hearings are not required for site plan applications, so yes, you could take action tonight.
Well, I'll just throw that open to the rest of the board. Does the board have any interest in taking action tonight?
Yes, I certainly do, Mr. Emery. I'd like to ask you are you concerned about the existing lighting?
Not particularly, no.
Okay. Any comments from the board?
I'd just say we typically have a public hearing, but I think the limited scope of the site plan review, I'm not sure that warrants the weight of a public hearing versus holding the applicant up for even a minimal amount of time.
Mr. Parker?
I would like to see action taken on this tonight as well.
Ms. Lardner?
Mm-hmm.
Do I hear a motion?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered. I don't. Yeah, we have to deem it complete first. Be it ordered that based on the plans, materials submitted, and the facts presented, the application of John and Jane McFaney for site plan review of a change of use from a beauty salon to Kinder Corner, a resale clothing shop located in the Pond Cove Shopping Center, be deemed complete.
Second the motion.
Any discussion? All in favor of that motion, raise your right hand.
May I vote?
You may. You're appointed. Thank you. Anybody got a second motion?
I have to think about it.
May I just ask a couple of questions?
Yes.
Did you indicate this is only used clothing, or will there be new also?
New and new.
And do you... how do the deliveries come for the volume of new clothing that you're going to be selling?
The new clothing will basically be underwear, and that will probably come UPS. The initial order will be, I can't even tell you the volume really. It'll probably end up being 100 dozen.
So a couple of boxes,
yes,
on whatever?
Yes, and then as that will basically be the extent of the new clothing is underwear, stockings, accessories.
And those would be the only bulk items of garbage you would be generating?
Yes.
And
as far as the other thing would be our initial setup, you know,
sure,
hangers and the equipment that we'll need, racks and stuff. But after the initial thing, it will just be replacing what's used, actually what's broken, because what's used will be reused.
And otherwise, people are walking into the storefront and showing you used clothing to see if you would want to purchase it. Is it a consignment type or outright purchase? But that's how you would receive your stock, by people bringing it in. Okay, I have no concerns then.
Is this about 1,000 square feet? 1,500? Approximately. Creative minds are at work over here on the right-hand side. Mr. Parkhurst.
We have a motion. Findings of fact. Number one, John and, is it Jane McKinney? Mm-hmm. They requested a change of use from a beauty salon to a children's resale store requiring view under section 19-2-10 of the zoning ordinance. Number two, the application was deemed complete at the September 15th, 1992 meeting of the Planning Board. Number three, the application substantially complies with the requirements of section 19-2-10. Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, that the application of John and Jane McKinney for site plan review of a change of use from a beauty salon to, is it Kinder Corner?
Kinder Corner.
Kinder Corner, okay. A resale clothing shop located in the Pond Cove Shopping Center be approved.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second the motion.
Any discussion? Mr. Emmons?
I propose that we just place one condition, that the applicant provide evidence of solid waste, whatever is part of the lease or whatever arrangement the applicant has with the owner of the shopping center. Just simply provide a letter or a section from the lease to the town planner.
Could he also meet that condition by stating that we will be removing all garbage and bringing it to the dump ourselves, if that's the case? Just some indication?
Certainly.
Would you like to put a time frame on your motion or your condition?
Well, I mean, you have a lease. You already have a lease.
That's
I would say within the next 7 days.
Yeah,
that's true.
Can't get through it quickly.
No.
Mr. Parkhurst, do you accept the proposed amendment to your motion?
I certainly do.
Mr. Edson, do you second it with the condition?
I do.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous? Thank you, Mr. McLean.
Thank you very much.
Good luck with your new plot.
Thank you.
Nicely done, thank you.
Practice makes perfect.
I beg your pardon?
Practice makes perfect.
No. Right out of there. Next item and last item of business tonight under new business is the Breggia public access waiver. Request by John Breggia for a public access waiver for lot U1-24 at the end of Charles Road in accordance with section 19-4-2 of the subdivision zoning ordinance. Before us tonight.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, ladies and gentlemen of the board. Good evening. My name is Mark Hampton. I'm with Sebago Technics representing Mr. Breggia tonight. I'd like to introduce the project and then address, if possible, some of the issues that have been raised through the review. As stated, Mr. Breggia is has requested a public access waiver to his property located at the end of Charles Road in Cape Elizabeth. Mr. Brage is the owner of record of property on the addresses of 17A and 19 Charles Road. This parcel is located at the end of Charles Road. Charles Road is a dead end. It has no turnarounds or cul-de-sacs at that point. The access to his property is just a driveway that continues off of the end of Charles Road. There are two existing single-family dwellings on his property. There is also a third property that's involved with this, and it's currently owned by Margaret LaRose. And it's involved in this in the fact that her access to her property has to cross Mr. Brage's property. The site plan that we submitted depicts existing conditions on both parcels. Included with the package was a letter signed by Ms. LaRose, which acknowledges her understanding and her agreement with the application. We have included a proposed easement with the application. This easement description, along with a copy of the plan depicting the easement right-of-way, would be proposed to be attached to all three deeds that we would be interested in. These deeds would include two deeds for Mr. Brazier, as well as one deed for Ms. LaRose's property. It is Mr. Brazier's intent to divide the parcel so that both dwelling units have separate deeds. In our application, we had addressed the standard requirements for the front or for the waive public access waiver. As a result of the application, T.Y. Lynn had submitted a number of responses to our application. And if I may, I'd like to go through those briefly and address the issues and acknowledge which ones we agree with and or take issue with. The first one, and probably the one that causes the greatest concern among all the individuals that I've addressed so far, is the question of whether or not this is a subdivision or that this is in violation of any proposed subdivision ordinance, be it the state or the town. And if I may give a brief description of the transactions that's taken place over the history of this property. In 1984, Mr. Brazier purchased the property, which is in total acreage is approximately 1.5 acres. If I can, that would be the property that was purchased in 1984 by Mr. Brazier. In 1985, Mr. Brazier divided this parcel, and this was recorded in deed and on plan with the Registry of Deeds. And his division at that point in time was made by the green line, separating the parcel and or the lot or piece of property into two parcels. At that time, Mr. Brazier constructed the home or the house currently located at 17 Charles Road. That's under current ownership by Ms. LaRose. After that was constructed, Mr. Brazier sought and received a building permit to construct one single family home on the remainder parcel, which being at that time in greater than 20,000 square feet, at that time it was 38,000 square feet in total area. It exceeded the minimum requirements for the zone, and he was granted the building permit and constructed the house.
Which house is that?
I'm sorry. That would be 19.
What year was that?
I don't know exactly the specific year that took place. That was after 1985. And then in, I believe, 1990, Mr. Brazier sought to build or receive a third building permit on the property to build the third house. That would be the house located on 17A Charles Road. At that time, he was informed that he could not do or receive the building permit because at that time, when that was created, he had 38,000 square feet, minimum lot size being 20,000 square feet. He only had a remainder of 18,000 square feet, which would be a non-conforming lot. So in order to deal with that issue, since at that time Mr. Brazier was still under common ownership with the property at 17 Charles Road and the other parcel, he made an amendment to the center line in order to grant, in order to get 20,000 square feet, or to make this whole parcel 40,000 square feet, which would meet the minimum requirements of the zone. It is our understanding and our opinion that because the first parcel was cut out and recorded in 1985, it has been greater than 5 years since that point in time. He deeded the change or the amendment in that property line was a deeded amendment or a deeded of land to an abutter, and consequently does not fall under the subdivision requirements of either the town of Cape Elizabeth or the state of Maine.
The change doesn't seem to appear on our plans.
No, it doesn't. It doesn't. The information that was provided to me by Mr. Brazier was provided from another surveying outfit, and for some reason that information didn't show up, and we're aware of that.
So the plan that is drawn indicates
the plan
those
is
those two lots are less than 40,000 square feet.
As the plan is drawn, they are, and we are aware that that would have to be obviously amended and properly addressed prior to approval. Yes?
Okay, the house on 17 Charles Road, 1985, was it sold to the people of 1985 as well?
No, it was not.
When was that conveyed to Mrs. LaRose?
It was conveyed to Mrs. LaRose in 1991. For the third house, yes, he did.
And it's constructed.
And it is constructed. All three dwelling units do exist.
On 140,000 square foot lot?
No. All three dwelling units exist on 165,000 square foot lot, plus or minus a few feet.
Well, there's two lots right now.
At this point, right. At this point in time, there are two lots.
Right.
One.
You have two lots, two homes on a 40,000 square foot lot. And
one
home
on a 25,786.
Where does Mr. Brazier live?
Mr. Brazier lives in 17A Charles Road.
Which was built in 1990.
I believe so, yes.
The question of the town planner, does that mean that the most recently unsubdivided, the 40,000 square foot lot is basically a two-family detached use with the town? Is that a conforming use?
They were issued building permits. I don't think there's anything in the ordinance that restricts someone to one principal structure per lot.
Is there any restriction on the number of houses? Could you build four if you had?
There's a restriction in terms of density. You have to have a minimum amount of lot size.
Right. But it wouldn't be a subdivision if there wasn't a subdivision of land in this community? If I had an 80,000 square foot lot, could I put four houses if I met all the standards without coming before this board?
I believe that the state subdivision statute says subdivision of land by lot or by building.
Or
so
by building.
So I think that if you
yes,
put
you're
four,
correct, it does.
So that's why you review condominium projects.
Hmm. Okay.
19 Charles Road appears to be encroaching on the fourth line of the driveway. Is that any of the address?
I'm aware in reviewing the plans that it does infringe on the water district right away or appear to on the plan. I don't know that it has been addressed to the water district or what the water district's response would be.
It seems to me that I'm assuming, I probably should assume, that the treasurer is looking for two separate parcels so you can sell one. Is that correct?
That's my understanding.
So if you find you're selling one, assuming that he lives in 17A, then it seems logical he'd be selling number 19. Seems to me like a little bit of a problem with title insurance, with it infringing on the 4-1 right away. So I think there's something that needs to be addressed at some point.
Could we just back up a minute? You have stated that the plan in front of us is an existing conditions plan, when in fact the lines on it don't depict the existing conditions. They depict some existing conditions and some of what the applicant would like to have depicted after the public access waiver is granted. Isn't that correct?
That is correct. I didn't mean to confuse the board, just to inform the board that the existing conditions did show on the site plan. If I may continue with the comments addressed by T.Y. Lynn. Their second comment related to noting a portion that of Mrs. LaRose's driveway crossing Mr. Bregia's property, and that there was no evidence provided that Mrs. LaRose had an easement across Mr. Bregia's property, and also that the planned 30-foot easement did not meet 30-foot easement in one location. We agree with what they've addressed. It was our intention, and it was the intention of the application, as it stated, that easements would be necessary among all three, or all, both parties involved, both Mr. Bregia as well as Ms. LaRose. The easement location that they're talking about that we did not pick up, that we will adjust, is located at a corner here, this triangular shape. We did not maintain a 30-foot distance across to provide an easement or a right-of-way as requested under the public waiver standards. And that will be amended. Their third comment was that legal description...
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt.
No.
What you're saying is you're going to move the easement?
We have proposed...
To move around that little triangle section?
Correct. What we've proposed is, as shown on the drawing, a 30-foot wide easement that occupies the driveway for 19 Charles Road. And we would propose, instead of that coming directly up to the property line, to stop and to move at an angle to the property line to maintain a 30-foot width at this location. But they're saying if you scale across that, you do not have a 30-foot wide right-of-way. And we're just saying we'll amend it so that it does maintain a 30-foot wide right-of-way. Third comment that T.Y. Lynn had suggested was that legal descriptions of the proposed properties and easements should be reviewed by the town attorney. And once they are drafted, we would have no disagreement with that being done. Their fourth comment was that the site plan was stamped by a professional engineer, and considering the property's legal descriptions and easements required, that they requested the town, or that the plan be stamped by a registered land surveyor. And we would agree to that as well. Their fifth comment, part of the existing conditions, which I noted on the plan, concerns two catch basins located along the center line of the driveway. We did not show an outlet to these catch basins, and they requested that we do show that, and we would agree to that. Their sixth comment regards the location of underground utility services servicing lots 19 and 17A to be located to ensure that they are not, or that they are located within the prospective proposed lots. And we agree to that. And their last comment was that building setbacks be shown on the plan. And we would have no problem showing that.
Question?
Yes.
Does through the chair, does your lot area calculations include the right-of-way?
Yes, it would.
It does. But the right-of-way is not owned in fee by the Portland Water District?
excuse me. I don't know the answer to that directly.
I'll just ask a question to the town planner. If a right-of-way is owned in fee, is that allowed to be calculated as part of the land area?
I'd have to talk to the code enforcement officer and see what their interpretation is. I mean, my interpretation would be that it should not be calculated. I mean, you should own the land, you have to own the land or have control over it in some manner. And I would assume that that's a Portland Water District easement type of right of way rather than owned in fee.
My assumption, actually I'm fairly certain of it, is that it is an easement, in which case it could be included in the density. Or the area. That would be something I would want to see for sure, though. It'd be a copy of that grant. Do we have any other comments just now? I'm sorry.
Yeah, I find the application quite confusing to figure out what's existing and what's proposed. And again, if the applicant is stating that he was simply given this drawing from a client and asked not to do any more work, I'm sympathetic to the situation. But before we can act on this, I think we need a very clear drawing that indicates what the existing property lines are, the areas that are included within the existing property lines, and then what the proposed dividing lines are, subdividing lines, new property lines, and the easement lines. The only other question I have, is there any consideration here for emergency vehicle access turnaround at the end of Charles Road? Is that a requirement? Or has that been reviewed by the... I would ask that that issue be reviewed by our fire and police and their concerns be addressed in the revised application.
As I understand it, the fire chief was in receipt of the package. And to my knowledge, made no comment on the package.
I think someone has got to review the copy of the deed that the Portland Water District has to seek to establish who actually owns that slice of land.
You're through, Steve? All right, Janet and then Judy. Janet, go ahead.
Mr. Hampton, I also found the plan confusing to read. I don't want to ask for unnecessary paperwork, but I'll tell you that what would be most useful to me would be to see one plan that shows existing conditions and then just show another plan with proposed, you know, boundary changes and whatever, so that it would be easy to see an existing something and then a proposed, and we wouldn't try to be doing it all on one. But I would leave that to your discretion.
Well, I agree. And it does get somewhat complicated when you're proposing to show easements, right-of-ways, existing conditions, edge of pavement, a number of different line types all in.
We all sympathize.
I would just, I guess it's getting late and I'm getting a little fired up here, not at the applicant, but I guess at the issue of land subdivision in Cape Elizabeth, and if this is what we're allowed to do within our existing ordinance, I think we've got some problems with that ordinance. It just seems to me that the lines that are drawn here and the way property is cut up and slashed up to make up 20,000 square feet isn't serving anyone's best interest. And it really, on a larger scale, I think demonstrates the need to have some sort of a master plan or whatever the term is for areas in town that are designated as development areas that might be controlled by one property owner. This just, to me, is not a satisfactory way of someone's house being tucked in behind somebody else's house and surrounded by three other houses. I guess I'd also like to have a public hearing and hear from the abutters on this as well. To a certain extent, it seems to me like we're treading water here. If these houses are already built, I mean, the board is really left in a difficult situation other than not to grant the public access waiver. And I guess at that point, the land could not be subdivided. Is that correct?
Well, I've discussed with Mr. Hampton why the applicant wants to get a public access waiver. Typically, you get a public access waiver so you can get a building permit. The building permits have already issued. My understanding is that there's a desire to clear up titles so that they can actually sell lots.
Judy Lardner, did you have something you wanted to say?
I echo what Tom just said. I certainly would like to see a public hearing, if only because of the comments we've received from the abutters, and I wonder if some of that might not be regarding the just the terminology of what these people are requesting. I know there can be confusion on the part of neighbors, but I would expect when the applicant comes back to address a lot of the things we've been talking about, I would want to see the deed to the larger lot and the LaRose lot. I would like to see the deed for the Portland Water District right-of-way or easement, whichever that is.
Excuse me. May I interrupt?
Sure.
Your first comment, you referred to a larger lot and the LaRose lot.
Well, the 40,000-acre lot that you're seeking to divide right now.
Right.
I would like to see proposed easements for the driveway, and I think somehow that has to affect all three lots.
Correct.
I would expect to see some sort of approval from the fire department or public safety that emergency vehicle access is adequate, because we always do look at that if there's a turnaround on the lot. Make sure that the property line is properly drawn, the area that you said had been amended. I don't know how this is obtained, but even if you show us that that's the Portland Water District easement, and I don't know if you have a meets and bounds description, but I would certainly be curious if you're going to try to sell that lot, that they know that that house may encroach on their easement, and that's okay. If this, the whole point of this is to clear up title problems and clarify that you can use the easement or right-of-way area as part of your calculations, and I would like all this stamped by a certified surveyor. But I see no problem going ahead and scheduling a public hearing.
I have one further comment, which is, in spite of everything else, I don't see why this isn't a subdivision. And I don't see why this isn't why you're here. I have the Maine Planning and Land Use Laws of 1990-91, and rather than belabor it, I'm just going to ask for the board to at least concur with me on getting a land use opinion as to this particular item from an attorney. The only way I see it falling out of the subdivision would be if the buildings, if it was divided by the division, the construction or placement of three or more dwelling units on a single tract in a five-year period. We're talking 5 years here. And I'm not sure whether the building permit was issued and the building not erected, but it's something that a land use opinion would have to address and would address as to actually when this occurred. Because if it doesn't fall within the five-year period, this would be in violation of the municipal subdivision law. And I can guarantee until you have that really corrected, your title problems will never go away, because that's not a public record. That's not going to be shown there, that it's not a subdivision.
Judith, couldn't they submit the deed showing that it was divided in 85 and show...
Oh, but it wasn't divided. That's the problem.
I thought it was conveyed in 91 but divided in 85.
But that doesn't change it.
May I suggest that I think that the subdivision law is sufficiently complicated, and it's not simply the division of land, but as has been indicated, it's also the construction of buildings. I would like very much to simply request an attorney's opinion to be provided by the applicant that would advise us whether or not the subdivision ordinance was applicable here.
That's fine.
Other than that, that was the major problem that I had. Everybody else has mentioned numerous other. I'm also very familiar with the property, as I actually sort of kitty corner. I live right in the area. And you can see the back of the two houses from my bathroom. I think we have enough issues right there to at least begin to move on to where we should be. Do we have a motion, or do we have any more discussion?
I have a motion, but I guess I'm intending to move that the application be tabled.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's take it first things first. I guess I'm also curious about whether or not we want to establish a date for a public hearing before we know more about what we've got here. But let's take it one thing at a time. The motion for the board to consider is, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of John Bredger for a public access waiver for lots located at 17A and 19 Charles Road be tabled until the regular October meeting of the planning board. Are you intending to come back then, Mr. Hampton?
That's fine.
Discussion? None? All those in favor, raise your right hands. Opposed? That's unanimous. The next item would be the discussion of whether or not we'll have a public hearing. I think my feeling is that we have enough coming in on just the application completeness.
Still to come in.
Still to come in.
But that's not an issue on public access.
I have a problem with whether this is going to be be reviewed as a public access waiver or a subdivision. And that may change it. That's my feeling. I would just as soon wait, but I will obviously defer to what the board prefers.
Just for the record, I disagree. I don't see what, if there's a finding that this is a subdivision, it changes everything. And if there's a finding this is a public access waiver, I, for one, would say we need a public hearing based on public comment, and that we'll just delay it another month. And that's just my opinion.
Madam Chair?
Mr. Edsel?
Question for the planner. Are we limited to only one public hearing?
There's nothing in the public access waiver standards that even discusses public hearings.
So if we have a public hearing and subsequent to that, other issues are under?
If you hold a public hearing and subsequently it's determined that this is indeed a subdivision, then the process basically starts for the subdivision and public hearing, and your time clock gets rolled back and you start all over again and you have another opportunity to do that.
I guess I have no problem scheduling a public hearing next to the regular meeting.
Okay. We don't have to vote on this, do we? We do.
Could I make a comment?
Yes.
I believe that it would be very possible for us to We understand the issue, and I understand the issue is if it is a sub, if it's not a subdivision, it needs to be a subdivision. Obviously, we're under much more stringent review and examination by the board, and much different standards to come back to. I would like to propose that we obtain a legal opinion within 14 days of today that I would submit to the planner, and if in fact it is, you know, if in fact we get a legal opinion that it is a legitimate division of land, not a subdivision, that we could proceed with the public access waiver. If it's a subdivision, if they deem that that's in violation of the subdivision laws, then there's no doubt that we would pull the application to drop back and then to refile for a subdivision, for a minor subdivision, as opposed to waiting a month, going through a public hearing or getting a decision rendered at that point in time and then coming back another month down the road.
That brings up the issue that the legal opinion would come after the time we publish for public hearing, and if there's a change, then we'll wait to time my public hearing.
More than town money, we've also, I mean, I guess I just like to ask neighbors to come once and not to come more than once if we don't absolutely have to.
So you go with me now, right?
Well, I don't know what to answer. I think it's an issue that I'd rather resolve.
I do too. I just feel it's there. In my mind, there are too many issues outstanding for me to entertain a public hearing.
Have all of the abutters been notified that this application is before the board?
Yes.
Okay.
Just so the board is aware, anytime a new item gets on your agenda, there's supposed to be a notice sent out that basically states that the planning board will begin to undergo review of the following items. So people should be notified anytime there's something on your agenda.
In light of that, I don't feel it's necessary to have a public hearing at the next meeting. I think it could be deferred until after we have more material to review.
All right. In which case, that's all we have to do. You have the motion where it's tabled to the next meeting. We'll come back and we'll take it from there.
I understand.
All right. And you're clear on all the items that...
I believe so.
Okay. If there's any doubt, let us know.
I will.
Is there any other business tonight? Why don't we bring up briefly, I have my own particular feeling about the December 22nd planning board meeting. I think that would be a really nice meeting to not have. But I will poll the board and see how you feel. And with your agreement, we will not have it. Mr. Parker.
Can we move it up a week to the 15th?
You really love this.
What does the load of the agenda look like at this point?
It's substantial. I don't know. I'll refer to Maureen on it. It doesn't look too bad. I don't know what In by the Sea is, nor Wildrose subdivision.
The tentative agenda which I sent to you is my best guess of what may be coming in. Of course, it's always revised. It's never right. The In by the Sea has been talking to me for probably 4 to 5 months now, and they haven't made an application yet. The Wildrose subdivision is the one that was being proposed by Mr. Weinschenk that you had an informal review. Probably the Ramshead subdivision will still be here.
I guess I'd like to suggest that it might be premature to try to make that decision now. I'd rather look at it in October or even November. Sure. And if we've got our workload reasonably under control, I'd be delighted to skip the meeting.
I would just say that in terms of, from an applicant standpoint, not having an opportunity to submit or have an application reviewed during a regular meeting during any month is a real hardship. And then if we don't schedule it for the 22nd, I think it should be scheduled for some time during the month, but not completely dropped.
I agree. We just scheduled another special meeting for the 29th of September. I can't see any reason why we wouldn't just move it up earlier in December.
Okay, that's all right. So we do it the Tuesday, the prior Tuesday? Or do you want to hold on it for...
We'll just wait and see.
Okay, that sounds good. In which case...
I move that the meeting is adjourned.
Oh, thank you. Second?
Second.
All those in favor? Raise hands. Unanimous. Thank you. Good night.